Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So this talk is going to be about a case for using trend filtering, and I'll tell you what that is, over the more commonly used splines. I'm starting my fifth year and hopefully final year at the machine learning and stats department at CMU. And this is joint work, and I'm also borrowing some slides from Ryan Tibshirani. Great. So at a high level, this is about non-parametric regression. This is there are going to be like two mathematical slides in this talk. The rest will be beautiful pictures. So we are think of the model where we're just observing x1, y1 to xn, yn. So we have n points, and where yi is f of xi plus some noise. Okay, and the errors have zero conditional mean. That's just like, you can imagine them to be Gaussian error or something like that. And we basically want to estimate f of x. We want to estimate that for some new x. So we want to estimate the expected value of y given x. So that's called the regression function. In other words, we just want to learn f, the mapping between x and y, if you want to think of it that way. And there's a rich literature on non-parametric regression, but most of it is for the one-dimensional setting where x's are in 1D. And that includes things like local polynomials, kernel smoothing, splines, wavelets, things like that. In high dimensions, typically these things start to suffer from the curse of dimensionality in just purely non-parametric regression. But in 1D, they often work really well in practice. Now, this talk is going to be about like a newcomer to non-parametric regression that you might not have heard about. And so for now, we're going to assume that we are in the 1D case. And for now, we're just, for the purpose of the talk, we'll just assume that x1 to xn are just evenly spaced points on 1D, and there's some function that we're trying to learn. Right? So here's an example. So like, let's say we make observations at equally spaced locations. So you know, these are the x's. And our observations are something like that. And this is what we call constant order trend filtering. In the sense, we want to fit a function like this. So this is actually a function that's fit, and it's piecewise constant, right? And that's what we want to do. Say we want to approximate f by this piecewise constant function. And this result out here is actually given by what's called the constant trend filtering problem, or the fused lasso. And the one-dimensional fused lasso problem is given by this optimization problem. So here, remember, yi are the observations that we have at our n points. And we are trying to find a beta vector, so an n-dimensional vector, such that we minimize the squared loss, so yi minus beta I the whole squared. And we have a penalty, which is like a sparsity penalty, if you're familiar with the lasso, in which we penalize beta I minus beta I plus 1. Right? So we penalize the difference between successive elements. Now, this is also called one-dimensional total variation denoising, constant order trend filtering, fused lasso. It has a bunch of names. And this encourages sparsity. So it encourages beta I to be equal to beta I plus 1. So that's why you get really a constant. And then really when it has to shift, it estimates a jump. But then again, it tries to reduce the number of times that this is non-zero. So it penalizes any difference. And it'll give you something like this. Okay. Now you can think of doing that for piecewise linear functions also. So same setup. But suppose we believe that the true underlying function is piecewise linear, then we might want a fit that looks somewhat like that. And that's again given by what's called the linear trend filtering problem. And again, it's given by an optimization problem where we're trying to find the best beta, which is close to my observations. But in this case, my penalty is something slightly different. It involves three observations. And the best way to think about this is that my sparsity penalty encourages each of those terms to be zero, unless it absolutely does, it violates being zero like a lot, like it costs you a lot in which case it changes the line. But when that is zero, we get that beta I plus 1 is beta I plus beta I plus 2 by 2, which means that beta I plus 1 is just the average of those two, which means you get a line. So you get a line, and then when it has to shift, you get another line. When it has to shift, you get another line, and so on. And so that penalty really tells you that, in some sense, the first derivative should be zero. Should be constant as much as possible, and the second derivative should be zero. You can now think about doing quadratic trend filtering. If just assume that, you know, we think that our underlying function is piecewise quadratic, then the quadratic trend filtering problem is given by the same thing with that kind of a penalty. And of course, where did this come from? You can write this down a little more generally. We don't have to write it in this fashion. So let's introduce just some notation. And we're going to write the 1D fused lasso problem, where it was, you know, just piecewise constants, as the two norms squared. So that was just the first part of it. And this sparsity penalty, where we're now penalizing D1 times beta. And D1 is the matrix with minus 1, 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, 1 on its rows. And so when D1 multiplies beta, we get beta 1 minus beta 2, beta 2 minus beta 3, beta 3 minus beta 4, and so on. So that's the that's basically a succinct notation for the constant order trend, the constant piecewise constant trend filtering problem.
Like a Pascal triangle thing.
Yeah, there we go. That's so the next order will look something like a Pascal triangle. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's exactly like the Pascal triangle, right? And so the linear trend filtering basically replaces the D1 beta with a D2 beta, where now you have minus 1, 2, minus 1. So it's like beta I minus 2 beta I plus 1 plus beta I plus 2. And it penalizes those differences. So I just plug D2 in there, and that would give me piecewise linear trend filtering. And basically, you should think about this as D2 as really being D1 times D1. It's really D1 multiplied by itself. So it's like the second discrete derivative, if you want to think about it that way. And similarly, if you want a kth order fit, like a kth order polynomial, then we use dk plus 1 beta. So we penalize the k plus first discrete derivatives. And the recursive relationship is just dk plus 1 is d1 times dk. So in some sense, you're like the k plus first derivative is the first derivative times the kth derivative. And so this is the discrete derivative operator of order k plus 1. And so basically, the kth order trend filtering penalizes the discrete k plus first derivatives and asks them to be exactly equal to 0 as many points as possible. Right, so this is just the formulation, and that's the notation that I'm going to use. Now, if your points were unevenly spaced, then that's not a big deal. You just change the instead of it being minus 1 and 1, you now have minus 1 by x2 minus x1. If your points were not at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, if they were not evenly spaced, you can just define the discrete derivative operator slightly differently, and then that relationship still holds. So, but for the rest of this talk, I'm just going to assume it's evenly spaced. I'll show you some experiments on when it's not, and it works fine. Right. So, the results extend to the uneven case also. Great. So, any questions at this point? That's what trend filtering is really. It's fitting piecewise constants, piecewise linears to some underlying one-dimensional function. The outline, I'm just going to give a few slides about what theory is known. And then I'll concentrate on the algorithms for solving it, and especially our really amazing algorithm for solving this problem. I'll give you a cute little neuroscience example, and I'll just show you how to extend it to other settings. Any questions about the basic setup? Okay. So what do we know about trend filtering theoretically? Well, not that much. This idea appeared in a paper by Kim et al. One of the authors was also Stephen Boyd. They suggested this in 2009. But an idea appears long ago by Mammen and Van de Geer in 97. And one of the key properties is that trend filtering estimates can be basically viewed as piecewise polynomials, and the locations of the knots are chosen adaptively. What do I mean by a knot? A knot is a point where it changes from one polynomial to another polynomial, and the positions at which it changes are chosen adaptively according to the data, because of the penalty really gives you that adaptivity. So those are, like, for example, some of the knots where it changes from one one piecewise cubic to another piecewise cubic or something like that. And the adaptivity comes from using that that penalty. And there are other options that you can do, you know, to solve this problem. And smoothing splines are one of the most popularly used algorithms. And they've been, I think people have been using them for 40 years or something like that now. I mean, at least a few decades. And people have engineered the heck out of smoothing splines. But we will. I'll show you some examples where really trend filtering might really be the right thing to do in many cases. And smoothing splines are similar, but they use a kind of L2 penalty instead of an L1 penalty. And so you can imagine that just like the lasso gives you better estimates if you believe that your underlying function is sparse, over here, the trend filtering really gives you the right estimates if you think that your underlying function has only a few changes in its discrete derivative. That is, the derivative is constant and then changes and then changes and so on. If you really believe that, then it gives you much better fits. And the big difference is basically that trend filtering can achieve exact zeros in the k plus first derivative, but smoothing splines can't. Okay, here's an example of a difference between a cubic trend filtering fit and smoothing splines. So if you notice, so this is called the degrees of freedom, and I'm not going to get into how we calculate that. But suppose we give them both the same number of degrees of freedom, the cubic trend filtering fit is much better in the sense that when it's less wiggly here, it's fitting to that. But then when it gets more wiggly, it's also kind of automatically adjusting to that. The smoothing splines, however, because it's less wiggly here, it kind of keeps the same smoothness here. It has to be less wiggly here, so it's not able to adjust to the different level of smoothness. If we give it some more degrees of freedom, then it does adjust more over here, but then its fit over here starts to look really dirty. Somehow this is able to adapt to the local smoothness of the function much better than smoothing splines. So if it's more wiggly there, it ends up being more wiggly in other parts also. So this is just one example of where the trend filtering fits seem to be much nicer than the smoothing spline fits. How about theoretically? So this is just going to be the second mathematical slide in some sense. This is from Ryan's earlier work. An asymptotic convergence rate for trend filtering. So assume that, you know, this is the model that we had, as I mentioned earlier. We have these x1, y1 to xn, yn from R cross R. Then there's an underlying model. Then we have this theorem, which is a result of Mammen and van der Geer, which was extended by Ryan, that basically, if the errors are independent, the epsilon i's, they're independent, and with sub-Gaussian tails, and fk has bounded total variation, so that means that its kth derivative, the kth derivative of f, the total one norm is bounded, then the trend filtering estimates of order k, that is, if I choose to fit k equal to 2, I mean piecewise linears, and if k is 3, then it's piecewise quadratics and so on. Then if I choose the right value of lambda, which is the penalty parameter, then the error, that is beta hat, my estimate from the true f at those points, f of x1 to f of xn, if I evaluate the error, then it drops to 0 at some rate. Okay, so you may be, the exact rate doesn't matter. What matters is that this is the minimax rate for that class. So basically, there's for this class of functions where the kth derivative has bounded total variation, trend filtering achieves the best possible rate for that class. While this rate cannot be achieved by kernels and smoothing splines and so on. So basically, all the other things that people use these days are actually not minimax optimal, but trend filtering is minimax optimal. There is a variant of splines called locally adaptive regression splines, which is minimax optimal, but much harder to fit computationally. So But what people typically use in practice is smoothing splines, and those are not really minimax optimal for if you believe that your true underlying function is of this form. Because this is just like some kind of theoretical reason for why we might want to use trend filtering. But of course, the main question is, how do we practically fit these things? Can we actually scale this up and, you know, get good fits in practice? So how do we actually get solutions? So it turns out that the trend filtering problem is much harder to solve than other non-parametric regression problems like smoothing splines, kernels, wavelets, things like that. Those are all really easy to fit, but trend filtering is much harder, and the reason is the non-differentiable penalty that you have over there. And so because of that, it's much harder to fit. And you can apply generic convex optimization techniques, non-smooth optimization techniques to solve this, and I'll show you examples of what happens. But the real problem that you come across is that this D matrix that we use, the discrete derivative operator, is extremely badly conditioned, and it gets worse and worse for larger k. So here's what I mean by badly conditioned. I'm giving you a log-log plot where this is log n, the number of points, and this is log of the condition number of the matrix. And basically, as k equal to 1, 2, and 3 is basically, if you're fitting a piecewise constant, linear, or quadratic, the condition, the log condition number is proportional to log n, which basically means that the condition number is like n to the k, like n to the 1, n to the 2, n to the 3. So the condition number of that matrix is n squared, n cubed. It's terrible. Like it's like the it's terribly conditioned. That is the ratio of the largest to the smallest singular vectors is really bad and gets worse with n and k. So that really affects the convergence rates of these algorithms. And here's an example of that. So you might say, okay, look, this is a classic first order problem. I can just apply a proximal method to solve it. And here's an example of what happens. So suppose you decide to use, so there are different kinds of proximal methods that you can have. You can decide to use a proximal gradient algorithm, an accelerated proximal gradient algorithm. You can take the dual and write it like a lasso and do proximal gradient on that or accelerated proximal gradient on that. And here's an example where n is just 1,000, so I have 1,000 points. And this is the solution after 20,000 iterations. And you can basically see that after 5,000 iterations, it's close. So this is proximal or accelerated proximal. After 10,000 iterations, it's really not made much progress. After 20,000 iterations, it's kind of close, but the real solution that we want is that. That's actually the optimum of the optimization problem, which is estimated differently. But if you tried a first order method, like after 20,000 iterations, you're really nowhere close to the final answer. And so here are, I mean, you can kind of see it more clearly here, where you know, you apply proximal or accelerated proximal gradient on the lasso formulation, and it really doesn't converge to the exact solution. And similarly, like if you on the present formulation, if you try to apply it, it's after 20,000 iterations, you're nowhere close to the optimum, right? So well, like that's a big problem. People are not going to use this if you don't get your final fit, no matter how good it is, you know, theoretically. So we, you know, suggested let's try and solve this using ADMM, right? So I'm not going to, maybe I'll describe what ADMM is later, but let's see how it works. So we just somehow, you know, derive the ADMM algorithm for this problem. And what you can see in black is the exact fit. Blue is just, it's a different coordinate descent algorithm. It's nowhere close after 5,000 iterations. And red is what's called the standard ADMM. So if you just close your eyes and you try to derive an ADMM algorithm, you'd get something. And it's 5,000 iterations, not 20,000 like the previous slide. But basically, it's still really, it's not good enough. It's really not reached the optimum, the black line, which is the exact solution. And so we're not happy with this. So what is the state of the art right now? So when Kim and Boyd and others, they proposed a really specialized primal dual interior point algorithm for this problem. And that's the current state of the art. It's just much better than first order methods, much better than coordinate descent and ADMM and things like that. And what we decided is to propose a specialized ADMM. And here's the fit of the exact solution, the primal dual interior point method, and specialized ADMM after 20 iterations. Okay, so this is just like completely different league. No, not 20,000, not 5,000. This is 20 iterations. And both of them have pretty much converged to like the optimum solution at that point. So clearly, you know, the specialized ADMM is doing really well. What I'll show you in future slides is it also outperforms, you know, primarily interior point on problems that we care about for at least. But for this really simple problem where, you know, you just want a piecewise linear fit, it's only 1,000 points. It's a really simple problem, 20 iterations, and it pretty much found, you know, the optimum. Yep.
Performance is only in terms of fitness here, because actually these curves look very close. I mean, in terms of, is there a way to estimate like predictive power and how much you generalize?
Yeah, no. So this is just so we can actually calculate the exact solution to this problem using a very costly method. That costly method doesn't scale up, but for this small problem, we could calculate the exact solution to the problem. And we just want to see how close do we are they getting to the exact solution of the problem. And so basically, like you have an optimization problem. You can get the exact solution. It's just impossible in practice to actually get it. But for this toy problem, we got it. And then we saw how different methods actually, how close did they get to finding that solution. And basically, how long would you have to run your algorithm before you actually got, you know, the optimum of that optimization problem that you're solving? Yep. Great. So what is this specialized ADMM? So now standard ADMM, you can derive the updates by rewriting your optimization problem in the following fashion. So I now rewrite it as a minimization over two things, beta and alpha. And that first term remains the same. It's just y minus beta squared. And now I penalize the one norm of alpha, subject to alpha being this dk plus 1 beta, right? So I didn't do anything great. If I just substituted dk plus 1 beta back inside there, I just have my original problem. So, but you derive standard ADMM by writing down this problem subject to alpha equal to dk plus 1 beta. And I'm not going to go through the process, but you can now, once you have, you know, some problem of this form, subject to some linear constraints, then you can actually just derive the standard ADMM updates. I didn't want to throw too many equations at you, but that's how you'd do it. Now, specialized ADMM is not doing that much different. It's just the only difference is that it leaves one of the Ds in there. So it actually leaves one D in there, and just in the constraints puts alpha equal to dk beta. So again, if I just put dk beta back in there, then I get back my original problem. And that's just the difference between the standard and the specialized ADMM. And it turns out the specialized ADMM works much better than standard ADMM, as I'll show you. And the reason is, again, because of the terrible the conditioning of dk plus 1 beta, conditioning that just gets worse with n and k, and because it solves a harder subproblem at each step in the same time. Okay, so what do the updates look like? So specialized ADMM, if you know, just derived the updates, I'm not going to, again, go into those details. You can look at them in our paper. But the final updates look like you update beta and alpha kind of alternately at every iteration. And the update for beta looks like a least squares kind of solve, except that this turns out to be a banded matrix, which means that it's basically a tri-diagonal or something like that, tri-diagonal when k is 1. And it's really, you can solve that in linear time. So inverting a banded matrix, you can use LAPACK in C++, and you can actually invert it in closed form in linear time. So this is actually just a linear time operation. And then you update alpha with this kind of a minimization problem. Let's not look too deeply into that right now. And then you have some dual variable u in which you do a dual ascent, and you update that. But each of these can actually be solved in order n time. So it's actually just one pass through your data, and you get each of these steps. So each step is really cheap. So that's what specialized ADMM does. If you want to look at the difference between the two, then the update for the real difference comes in this step, like what's going on. The real difference comes there. Standard ADMM is solving a problem like that, where I'm minimizing alpha minus something squared plus one norm of alpha. And that's just soft thresholding. So if you're familiar with the lasso 1D, the proximal step for lasso, this is just that. You soft threshold that vector, right? So that's what the standard ADMM does. Specialized ADMM has pretty much the same looking first term, but the second term is slightly different. It turns out that there's an exact dynamic programming solution that finds this optimum also in linear time. So soft thresholding is is a linear operation. You just go through all your elements of the vector and you get your solution. And it turns out that this also is actually just linear time. And so this is a specialized thing. The reason that specialized ADMM is doing better than standard ADMM is firstly that in some sense it's doing more work in the same amount of time. Like this is doing a kind of a trivial operation at each step. This is doing a somewhat more sophisticated operation in the same amount of time. And secondly, it's only in this inversion that takes place. Standard ADMM has k plus 1 there, while this has k there. And so like in some sense, its conditioning is much better. So here's an example of, you know, it just, there's no comparison between the two methods. On the x-axis, I have iterations. And on the y-axis, I have the objective value. And basically, the black line is standard ADMM. And the red line is specialized ADMM. And specialized ADMM just blows away standard ADMM. So its criterion value pretty much goes down to the minimum possible criterion value, like really quickly. Like, and yes, standard ADMM would probably reach it at some point. And this is for high, medium, and low lambda. So I've not spoken much about this lambda parameter, but you have this tuning parameter. And suppose it's high, and by high, I mean pretty much close to the maximum value at which point you'd get a trivial solution. Just like for the lasso, if lambda was high enough, you'd just get all zeros. Over here as well, if lambda is high enough, then you'd just get a trivial solution. Low, I mean like 10 to the minus 5 times the maximum lambda, and middle is, you know, somewhere in between, which is not too high and not too low. So this was like 10,000 points, and there was like a Doppler kind of function which changed frequency. I was fitting a piecewise linear function to it. A piecewise quadratic function to it. And in pretty much all regimes of regularization, the specialized ADMM just this completely outperforms the standard ADMM. And these are all implemented in C++, and it was like as cleanly done as possible, handling the, you know, the sensitive issues of conditioning and things like that, and still there's no comparison. But I told you the state of the art was primal dual interior point, and so you might want to, you know, ask how does it perform with respect to primal dual interior point. And so here's an example of a sinusoidal function, so just a sine wave, and I'm fitting say a piecewise linear to it, 10,000 points, and again high, medium, and low ranges of regularization. And pretty much both primal dual and special ADMM have like extremely fast convergence. So primal dual interior point is known to have like quadratic convergence pretty much everywhere. And ADMM, people think, is linear convergence pretty much everywhere. But for all practical purposes over here, it seems like they both converge really, really quickly. What if you scale the problem up? Suppose you have 100,000 points, then it still seems like there's not much difference between the algorithms. You're starting to see some effects of the conditioning coming in for primal dual interior point. So this was also a C code that Boyd and Kim and others of his group released. And so we basically took their C code, just generalized it to higher K values. But their C code was for K equal to 1. And this is pretty much what that does. So right now, you don't see a difference between the two algorithms. But the difference starts to come in when you go to higher k, and you know, you have 10,000 points, but k is 2, and your condition number just basically, yeah, instead of n to the 1, it's now n to the 2. So it's just your condition number blew up, and primal dual interior point really gets hit by that. So if you look at the steps right in the middle of the interior point method, it involves dealing with really badly conditioned matrices and solving basically linear systems with terribly conditioned matrices. And then you start to see basically that that primal dual interior point gets hit quite badly, at least at high and medium lambda, not so much at low lambda. But if you scale the number of points to 100,000, you have 100,000 points, you want to fit a piecewise quadratic function to an underlying sinusoid, then yeah, basically primal dual interior point starts to hit this really bad conditioning areas where you have a lot of zeros and you're trying to invert and things like that. But specialized ADMM is really robust, basically. It's really robust to these things. Now, suppose you want to fit a piecewise cubic. No, normally, you don't go more than cubic in practice. Piecewise cubics is all that that people do. And you get the same behavior, really, for k equal to 3 also, that primal dual interior point doesn't converge, but this one, specialized ADMM, does. And so those results are in our paper. So you can actually get The way people typically solve this in practice is they like to get an entire regularization path. That is, they like to solve it for several lambdas and visualize the solution. And so what you actually do is you warm start. You start from the highest lambda where you have a trivial solution. And then for the next value of lambda, you start from the previous solution and so on. So you warm start. And that usually is faster and more stable and things like that. And so we have an example basically here where, say, you have an underlying sign. And that's what the fits look like for different values of lambda. So the black one is basically the highest value of lambda. And so it's really highly regularized, and so it just doesn't allow it to vary at all. And then as you get to low lambdas, you can start to see some wiggles over there. And at the medium range of lambda, you get like beautiful fits. But basically, you can get the entire range, and you can look at the convergence rate also for each lambda, and it's pretty much stable across the entire regularization path. Our specialized ADMM is stable, but the primordial interior point is just not that stable. You get great convergence. But this was when the points were even. You just got exactly even points. Suppose you had uneven points. So here I've sampled points as like a mixture of two Gaussians. And so I have really dense points here and very sparse in other places, things like that. So the fits look really similar, especially at the middle values of lambda, which you really care about, not too high and not too low. The fits look really stable. The convergence gets affected a little bit by the fact that it's uneven. And that basically because, again, the condition number of D is affected by you putting in uneven points there. But it's still, like I would say, really good, really stable, really robust in some sense. So here's an example of maybe a real-life application of this. So this is a neuroscience example. So, I mean, you have your brain, and maybe you're interested in some part of the brain. It's called the LOC, and that's region of the occipital lobe that's believed to play a role in object recognition. Okay, and a question that people wanted to ask was, how long does it take that area of the brain to pick up a difference between two objects? Okay, say between faces and non-faces. Now, this data was taken from Yang Zhu, who's a PhD student in our department, advised by Rob Cass. And the data looks like this. So people ran an MEG experiment in the following fashion. The setup is simple. You show someone a face, okay, like Obama's face or something, and you record the activity, especially in that part of the brain, using MEG over time, over 300 milliseconds. And you do this 191 more times. Okay, so you show a face and you make a recording. And you do something else, or you show them a house. And you record the activity over a 300 millisecond time window at that part of the brain, and you do that 191 more times. Okay. So what you have is what you want to ask is, at what time point does that part of the brain start to process a house and a face differently? Okay. So it's time. When does it actually start to recognize objects? And what time point does that happen? Okay. So the way the data is processed is in this fashion. So MEG recordings are made at multiple locations in that area of the brain. And so what we have is two sets of observations. Fij of t talks about the faces, so F for faces and H for houses. And basically for the ith face, for the jth location in the brain, we have the recording as a function of t. And again, for houses, for the ith house that I showed you, and for the jth location in the brain, we have the reading as a function of t, right? And so what they do is typically they measure some kind of distance between f of t and h of t, some Mahalanobis distance between them, and we're going to call that delta t, okay? And that's there. So they come up with this number, and that's what they typically do. And then they plot it, and that's what it looks like with time. That's what delta t looks like with time. And they want to know when is there a difference between f of t and h of t. So when does delta t actually start to show a difference? So when does it deviate from zero? So, but when they actually plot this, I mean, of course, because the brain is really noisy, you don't get, you don't get zero values there. You get something that's non-zero. And you could try fitting something to it. You could do trend filtering or smoothing splines. But what you'd get is, you'd never get something that was zero difference, and then the difference starts. So, you'd just get some some fits with a smoothing fly-in and some fit with a cubic trend filtering, right? You'd get something and you have no idea really at what point of time exactly there's a difference. And so what you might want to do is also introduce a sparsity penalty that encourages a zero fit at some points in the data, right? So you might want to have a sparse trend filtering. So you want to do trend filtering but also encourage sparsity, right? So you additionally penalize the terms to be nearly zero, right? So you have your usual trend filtering problem, but you also think, okay, I also think that it should actually be equal to zero at some points. And so you can now, derive the algorithm for this instead. And have two tuning parameters, and typically the way we do it is cross-validation. So you do cross-validation to pick these parameters. And here's what you get. You get a sequence of fits, and you choose the best fit according to, say, cross-validation. And at a very high lambda, at high regularization, it tries to put it zero pretty much everywhere. At really low regularization, it's pretty much the original trend filtering fit. But if you try and cross-validate and find the right point, then the fit that you actually come up with looks like that. So you have a sparse fit which is zero, and then you see like a difference. And it leaves zero at a particular time point, which is around 70 milliseconds, which is consistent with the literature. And what this example just shows is that suppose you had some extra knowledge and you thought it was sparse, it's really actually really easy to change the trend filtering algorithm a little bit. The updates just change a little bit. The rest of the properties of the algorithm remain the same. It's really robust. It converges really quickly. So it works really well in practice and gives you something that basically practitioners want, the degree of flexibility that you actually want. And so a key advantage is basically that it's really easy to extend. And here are three examples. So one I showed you was sparse trend filtering. So suppose you believe your true function is sparse. A regular trend filtering would, just fit some piecewise polynomial. But the sparse trend filtering would actually make that equal to zero and then followed by some polynomial, right? Suppose you had some outliers, okay? So you have some points that are just outliers. And you can add an outlier detection term to your penalties, and the red curve is what the regular trend filtering would fit. So where there are outliers, it would, just have a really ugly fit. But an outlier adjusted trend filtering would, have a much more reasonable fit. Suppose you believe that your function was isotonic, which means that it's an increasing function. A regular, trend filtering fit would be something like that, the red one. And an isotonic fit, which is increasing, you can easily put, it's a really simple term to add in. And it just has a perfectly increasing fit. So it becomes flat and goes increases. So you get these really, depending on whatever, additional thing you know about your data, you can easily put that in. The algorithms are really easy to derive and really robust to all of these changes and things like that. So, I believe that trend filtering is, it's a new approach, but it's a really competitive approach to splines, and we have several reasons to use it. First reason is theoretical. It's minimax optimal. If you really believe that the underlying function or its derivatives have bounded total variation, or it's basically that it's piecewise constant or linear, then it's minimax optimal. It's now like computationally efficient with our algorithm. It's computationally efficient and very robust for like really large problems. You don't have any numerical issues and things like that. The experiments on real and simulated data are extremely promising. And extensions to variations like isotonic, sparse, outlier, those kind of things are really easy. But I think people should really try this out on their own and develop their own their own opinions on trend filtering. And because of that, we have made the code public. So it's all written in C and super optimized and everything. And it's now available in the R package called genlasso. Genlasso stands for generalized lasso. So it's generalizations of the lasso problem, and particularly in the function called trend filter. And so there's documentation online available with this about how to use that function, but it's really easy. You just call trend filter with your input data, input set of points. And if you just leave it like that, it'll calculate it over an entire sequence of lambda values. You can also provide one lambda value if you want, and you just get the fits then. And you have to provide k, which is you want piecewise constant or linear or quadratic. And so it's really easy to use. Just put in your data and you get back fits. Really robust, and it's free. So go ahead and try it out. But I think that's all I have to say. I definitely want to acknowledge Ryan. This is mostly like, I think he's been working on it for a few years. I just, this is not related anything to my thesis or what I usually do, but I like working with Ryan, so like I worked on this project as well. Thank you.
Any questions?
Yep.
I think, yeah, I'm good. So with kernels, it's really easy to extend things to more than one input dimension,
yep.
Right? So how do you do that here? Is there anything known about this?
Yeah. So I think, so there are extensions to higher dimensions. It just like as dimension increases, it gets numerically harder. Again, conditioning gets harder and things like that. So, but definitely these algorithms work in higher dimensions also. I mean, you can derive a similar, the penalty just becomes a two-dimensional L2 squared penalty and a two-dimensional Lasso kind of penalty. And so presently, I think Ryan is working with another student on graph trend filtering. So you have an underlying graph and you think your signal is piecewise constant or linear or quadratic over the graph. And deriving algorithms of that sense. So it'll be the same penalty, but with a Laplacian Laplacian times beta that you're penalizing. So yeah, I mean, you can definitely derive extensions of this to higher dimensions or to graphs and things like that. And so I think the graphs are still, I think it works reasonably well for graphs, but I think higher and higher dimensions, it'll start to have numerical issues. I think theoretically, it'll probably still, I think, be optimal in higher dimensions also, but I think practically it might suffer from numerical issues of actually finding the solution to the problem.
But would you have dynamic programming for that sub-problem still work in this?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know. No, I don't know.
It relies on the ordering of the points.
Yeah, it does rely on the linear ordering of the points. That's right, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I can get back to you on that. I don't remember what the best thing is to do in higher dimensions. Yeah, we've really been concentrating on one, because I think people in time series use 1D a lot. And so at least in all the cases in 1D where it's used, for example, sparse additive modeling, people want to fit a one-dimensional function. You can use this instead of splines or kernels.
I really like it for the kind of switching time series type of things. It looks much more straightforward than these kind of Bayesian models about, that try to do this.
I agree. I'm pretty frequentist, so I think this is a better way to go. But I think the graph stuff works really well in practice also, and you get actually like much better. Like we've tried it out over like U.S. data, so you have the U.S. world map, and you say you have the flu in some parts of the U.S. and little lesser in other parts, and you want to actually get some kind of a fit, and it comes out pretty. Works really well in practice. You get some nice fit, much better than a smoothing spline, which gives you basically, non-zero everywhere kind of thing. Rather than that, this one actually gets you more localized answers. So I mean, it works well. Higher dimensions, I don't know what the best thing is, but it's a very recent proposal. Like I think 2009 was when Boyd and Kim and others they proposed it in that paper. So I believe that soon we should have scalable algorithms for it. Like I think it's reasonable to believe that it'll work well, at least like a 5-10 dimensions, things like that. I mean, it's not going to work in thousands probably, but I think it should be soon.
For the 1D case, I mean, is it safe to assume that usually X is time?
Yeah.
In most examples, I mean,
yeah, that's reasonable, yeah.
And with the jurisdictional, basically, these techniques can't create anything beyond time T. I mean, you can't have any
creative
power
on T plus
1, let's say. Oh, no, I mean, I think that's reasonable. I mean, you can definitely predict what happens at T plus 1, sure. You put in X T plus 1. I mean, now you've learned a function. You've learned an underlying function. So you can predict what happens at T plus 1. Now, I mean, that's if you believe that the trend doesn't suddenly change at T, like then, yeah, sure, it would continue the same trend at T plus 1, and so you'd get a fit for T plus 1, T plus 2. Yeah, and it would just, yeah, exactly, right. But I think typically it's for intermediate parts and things like that, or you get really noisy data and you just want to know what's the real underlying function.
Has there been any evaluation on time series for
incorporating the future?
In
financial data or things like that, has there been?
No, but I think he's working on some stock market stuff, Jason, right? Yeah. So maybe he'll have some extensions to time series, but... No, I mean, we haven't tried it on that. So our focus was on basically on deriving scalable, really robust efficient algorithms for it. Yeah. Yep.
So it looks like you could break it down into a series of almost parametric problems. Mm-hmm. You know the form of the solution, right? You know there are these switching points. Mm-hmm. And
but you don't know where they are.
In principle, you could, you would have to structure it over how many there are, your search. You start with 0, 1, 2, and then for each one of these, you would look, you would go through the possible points that you have. I'm just wondering if, is there a reason why that shouldn't work? Or is that maybe your exact method that is
exactly,
incredibly...
Yeah, exactly. So there is, that's the, So basically, there is a method that basically does that, and it's actually a path algorithm. So it over the entire sequence of lambdas, it calculates all the exact knots and then actually fits the thing exactly over those knots. Yeah, that's exactly the exact method. And just that, like, and you start to get, so for example, at slightly low values of lambda, you start to get thousands of knots. And at that point, it starts to become crazy to actually fit and things like that, yeah. But that's the exact method, which is why for small problems for 1,000 points you can actually do it. If you know that there are very few knots and things like that, then you can actually do it.
Is that exact method also in the R package?
In fact, that was the earlier method that was there. So basically, so the trend filter function in genlasso was there before I started working on this problem, and they had the exact thing there, but it just didn't scale. And then you tried. Any other methods, and they were not robust. And so when we tried to find something that was robust and scaled, and but it's also there, yeah. Yep.
So two questions. One is the interior point method.
Yep.
What was the cost of each iteration? I mean, you
compared... It's all order n, actually. All of the methods, proximal gradient, axial proximal gradient on the dual primal coordinate descent, ADMM standard order specialized primal dual. Basically, it turns out that those matrices have a very special form, and because of that, you can solve them in linear time. I'm assuming k is 1, 2, or 3, basically. You're never going to really solve more than piecewise cubic. So I think it's nk maybe or something like that. But yeah, basically, you get linear time solves. And that's why we don't do it in MATLAB because we don't want to do inv or something like that. We actually write code that solves it exactly.
I have a variation of the problem, and it might be interesting to get your thoughts on whether this would be a good fit, where in fact you want to you have a number of trends,
yep.
And you're not penalizing trend switching. You basically say that there are four trends,
yep.
And I want all the data to be explained by four trends, but
okay.
Trends can reappear.
Okay.
Right. So basically, there was trend one, like there was this function which was used for this part of the data. It could reappear at like. Later on.
Yep. So I mean, so why would this not work in that setting? Like, if you just, it would switch to something else and then switch back. So if it was a good fit, it would do exactly that. It would fit three different trends, and the first might be the same as the third.
But the point is, there is a different way, right? In the earlier model, we will penalize that transition.
The transition.
Right. I'm not going to penalize any transition. I'm just basically saying I want as few sort of trends as possible,
right.
And I'm not going to worry about how many times it might happen that you actually transition every other point.
Okay.
But I don't care. I'll not penalize you.
Okay.
I just want to minimize the number of trends. Do you see my point?
Yeah. You want to minimize the number of underlying trends or something like that. So it's.
I'll not penalize switches.
Right. So there's a Okay. Well, that's interesting. I don't think I've thought about it, but I think this. It might be possible to just rewrite this in such a way that it takes that into account, and we can talk more about it. But yeah, that's an interesting problem, and you can maybe describe where it comes up so that I really understand what's going on. But
okay.
I'd be happy to learn.
I'll tell you basically in computer vision, right?
Yeah.
In computer vision, basically, suppose you're looking at the depth,
yep.
along a sort of a row of pixels.
Yeah.
Okay. Now what happens is each object that you see will have a simple sort of a planar sort of surface,
mm-hmm.
right? And suppose I am occluding this piece.
I see.
Right? So when you see this, you see the transition, you will see this plane,
right.
And then you will see something else, and then you will see this plane again.
Right.
So my assumption is that I have my scene is composed of some number of objects, right?
Right.
And I now want to sort of explain all the depth data
right.
with as few objects as possible.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's, I mean, makes sense. Now, I mean, I got the problem and the setting and everything. Yeah, makes sense. And would that be a 2D or 3D, 2D problem or something typically, or something like that, right?
So it could be a 2D problem, but the point is the basic idea generalizes to even the stock market. So suppose you, there are different operation modes, right? There are different, there is a mode where a sort of Goldman Sachs stops trading or it doesn't trade.
Mm-hmm.
Right, there are two modes,
mm-hmm.
right? And stock market behaves completely differently in those two modes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we know that there's one Goldman Sachs
mm-hmm.
and it will have two states, either it operates or it doesn't mm-hmm. operate. But we don't know like how many times basically it operates,
mm-hmm.
right? So we just want a two-state model of the whole market,
mm-hmm.
right? Without sort of considering into account the actual number of times
yep.
The Goldman Sachs would actually come in.
Right.
Do you see my point?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. But somehow, I mean, the earlier vision example that you gave sounded like a reasonable, like, that's actually true that it's like that. But like the financial one doesn't sound like, so I happen to have worked at this hedge fund before I joined grad school. And that doesn't sound like. I mean, it's possible that you could. Yeah. There could be other applications for it, right? I believe that it's not just restricted to vision. I mean, that's interesting. I haven't thought about that, but I would like to think about it because if it actually has a practical application, then sure, why not? Yep.
So suppose we're in the linear case,
yep.
a piecewise linear case,
mm-hmm.
and there's in fact data that seems to indicate it looks more like it's. Constant.
Okay.
Then what does it do? Does it, I mean, is there some trend from making that coefficient, that linear coefficient, zero?
Yeah, so we can actually have, so there's another extension that we have, which is mixed trend filtering, which is basically, it'll try and see, I mean, so if you just fit this, it would do piecewise linear everywhere. And then even when it was piecewise constant, it would try and fit a line. It won't actually be constant. It would be just not slightly not. So we have a version which is called mixed trend filtering, which would try and do a bit of both. But I think the problem just becomes the tuning parameters. How do you set the two lambda values basically? And I guess if you did cross validation, maybe it would be reasonable. But then it starts to get more expensive if you have to loop over two parameters rather than one. But I think that. You can write an extension. The good part about this, is you come up with an idea, you can write an extension of the algorithm down, and it's fairly, like, you can write down easily what the updates would look like and things like that. Yeah.
Okay, so Aditya will stay here for a couple more hours, I think. So any one-to-one that you would like to have with him, we can arrange that. And
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.